you mentioned a few, you know, types of a few approaches to this kind of generative modeling, you know, autoregressive, non-autoregressive. You mentioned large language models, you mentioned diffusion models. And my general question is that I feel that, you know, there are a lot of people who, you know, see this hype and want to be also part of it in a way. And if someone wanted to start, you know, working on generating music with deep learning from either from an implementation point of view or from a starting point for their own research, which resources would you recommend to learn this new and emerging field?
So I'd say the thing to do is to go out there and start playing with open source and open weights models. So if you're interested in language models, then Llama or something like this. If you're interested in music and audio, then Stable Audio Open is a great place to start. I mean, just because of the resource constraints, you're probably not going to be training your own models from scratch as someone new to the area on your own laptop or even on like some cluster that you've rented at like certain cost per hour. It's much better to start from publicly available base models. I mean, and there's huge communities around these things. So in the language model space, like there's a massive open source community around Meta's Llama models, around the models coming out of Mistral. And there's people fine tuning these models. There's people making up new applications and ways of using these models. Like it's just, yeah, it's just, I it's hard to even say where to start because there's so much. I mean, a lot of this work goes on in Discord, various Discords, but like looking around GitHub, we all find stuff as well. In the audio space, I think our base model is a great place to start. We also have all the code available. We have our own library for training these models called Stable Audio Tools. And we actually have a Discord server called Harmony, which I guess we can post a link to with all this content, where there's a bunch of people like messing around with these models, training them on their own music, like trying to do new stuff with them. And in the image space, there's also a huge community around Stable Diffusion, which is similarly actually mostly on Discord, but also GitHub. I mean, I can't say much about that space because I'm not deeply in that community, but like it's actually an incredibly, compared to getting into doing DSP, there's so much more activity and there's so much more like, yeah, resources out there for this stuff at the moment. It's much, much easier. Like there's lots and lots of people who are tinkering with this stuff in their spare time in their bedrooms. So yeah, that's the way to get into it. Just, you know, download a model, try doing some inference, try like fine tuning it on your own data, maybe trying, you know, a new method of interacting with it, or like, yeah, the sky's the limit really. But yeah, it's really about, I think, taking pre-trained base models and playing around with them. If you want to get into training base models, then that's harder because you need resources. And it's also hard to develop intuition about training base models just from doing small. Actually, I had a conversation with a colleague who's mostly done DSP from another music tech company recently, who was just getting into this kind of stuff. And he had exactly the approach that I would expect from a traditional DSP person or engineer, of being like, okay, let's build this up from small to large. Let's start training on like 100 samples, see where that goes. Like, let's see what happens when we do 500. And I kind of pushed him away from this because AI doesn't work like that, unfortunately. You will, like, conclusions that, like, smaller models are harder to train in many ways than large models. I mean, it's not hard to train a small model with not much data to overfit and just reproduce inputs, but that's not what you want, right? You want something that's actually creative. And to do that, you need a lot of data. So doing experiments on small amounts of data and extrapolating from that doesn't necessarily get you that far and can actually give you kind of misleading conclusions about what's important. So that's a bit of an annoying, depressing conclusion for people who want to come in and train base models, right? So I guess what you have to do is get really good at engineering or come up with new ideas and manage to get into a company that has the resources, or a university lab, actually, that has the resources to have a go at training this stuff at the scale that's necessary. I mean, people do this. Like, this one guy on Twitter, or X, or whatever you want to call it at the moment, who's on his own basically training a state-of-the-art image generation model to compete with Stable Diffusion. Like, one guy on his own. I mean, he's got a grant for some compute that he's managed to get from some generous person, but like, yeah, that does happen, but it's rare. So building base models is normally like a group activity with resources. And you'll see that with things like Llama. Like, Llama 3 has like a credits list that's like pages and pages long. Like, it's had a team of hundreds working on it. Like, these things are big and expensive and require like a huge amount of person power and compute.
Yeah, definitely. I can see that in all the, you know, modern deep learning papers, the list of names is typically very long. So even in your StemGen paper, it's like 9 people credited there. So
yeah, sure. I mean, that's also partly just my
generosity.
Like, you always have a core you have a core team working on a paper, and then you have people who have been involved. And like, I tend to feel like it doesn't cost you anything to include someone if they've contributed something. So like, I know some people try and keep authors lists shorter and then just put people in the acknowledgements. I tend to just put people in as co-authors, because why not? So, I mean, that's also something that happens. Like, different areas have different citation approaches now, or different author list approaches. Like, I mean, in big physics labs now, I think CERN is the famous one, right? Like, they literally list, I think, everybody who works at CERN every time they put a CERN paper out. Maybe they even randomize the order. I kind of like that, because research, whilst it will have someone driving it, like, it's always a group effort, right? Like, there's always people contributing to various degrees, and like, it's important that those people get recognized.
Okay, nice.
And it's important for people to understand that this stuff is a group activity mainly.
Okay.
I don't like this traditional idea of like the solo mad scientist or auteur like doing all the magic on their own. Like, I think most of the time that's complete rubbish. That's not the way it works. And anything we can do to fight against that narrative is good.